Hey everyone, Israel is currently in a war against the terror organization Hamas, and we know how hard it can be to keep up with all the news. So if you haven't had the time to stay on top of the latest developments out of Israel, we're here for you. I'm Adar Gavelazi, and this is ILTV's Weekly Review. Day 187 of the war in Gaza, and while most Israeli troops have been withdrawn from the enclave, the IDF is continuing heavy military pressure. Tanks are patrolling along the border, and airstrikes are being called in whenever and wherever Hamas operatives emerge. This, as Prime Minister Netanyahu says yet again that a Rafah operation is circled in the calendar. More from ILTV's Steve Leibovitz.
Israeli forces have stepped up bombardments on Deir el-Balah in central Gaza, as well as Rafah, two areas the IDF has yet to enter in ground operations. The targeting of Hamas is ongoing, with tanks deployed along the border amid frequent airstrikes when called in as Hamas operatives emerge. Speaking to new IDF recruits, Prime Minister Netanyahu stated once again that the IDF will eliminate remaining Hamas brigades, regardless of what the rest of the world says. Netanyahu made the statement a day after saying that a date has been set for an Israeli operation in Rafah without disclosing the date. Meanwhile, Israel is facilitating the ever-increasing amount of international aid entering Gaza in record amounts. 468 humanitarian aid trucks were inspected and transferred to Gaza. This was the highest number of aid trucks that entered Gaza in one day since the start of the war. Despite Israeli efforts, aid organizations say that trucks are coming in, but distribution remains a major problem.
And when you put up statistics with numbers of trucks going in, saying, look at all these hundreds of trucks going in, and you put it against, look how few trucks have actually moved around with the distribution, well, it's kind of an own goal, isn't it? Because half of the convoys that we were trying to send to the north with food were denied by the very same Israeli authority.
And looking back to October 17th, when an explosion took place in the parking lot of Al-Ahli Hospital, resulting in hundreds of casualties, Israel was widely blamed, even though evidence proved damages were caused by a misfired terrorist rocket. An Islamic Jihad member has now admitted how they and Hamas manipulate the media to turn their lies into international headlines.
معينه لا هذا من عند الاحتلال والاستهداف كان بشكل مباشر وهناك تصوير وهناك زاويه واستندوا على اكثر من روايه من بعض الروايات الاجنبيه الصحف الاجنبيه
اوكي وبعدين وضعوها لكل الدنيا
اوكي The lies of the terrorists believed by much of the world.
Well, Israel is facing mounting scrutiny internationally over its handling of the Gaza war as the painful conflict wages on. But is it justified? Here to speak with us about the morality of Israel's war in Gaza 6 months on is one of the leading experts in urban warfare today, the chairman of the Urban Warfare Studies at the War Institute at West Point, retired U.S. Army Major John Spencer. Major Spencer, thank you so much for joining us today. I want to start by asking you about what Israel has achieved 6 months on, and given the fact Israel's facing pressure to implement a ceasefire, what's the right thing to do at this point?
Yeah, I think from every metric, Israel has been able to achieve their goals. They're not done yet. They have to finish the job. But they've been able to destroy 19 of the 24 Hamas battalions, reduce the military of Hamas and its military capability to a very small portion. They've returned half of the hostages home, and they will return them all. They have cleared dense urban terrain within 6 months, massive cities down to a small portion left to be cleared. I think by every metric, they've been effective, to include the rockets that Hamas still has. And this is why the entire Gaza Strip needs to be searched. But the rockets went from 4,000 a day to zero, or a few intermittently.
Absolutely. Now, much has been said about this 30,000 casualty number provided by Hamas. And of course, they include a high number of children who were allegedly killed. What can you tell us about these numbers based on your expertise in urban warfare? How accurate might they be?
I would be very skeptical of any number provided by Hamas, one. And two, in any battle, in any war, of having a daily running civilian casualty count down to a single digit. I mean, it's a fact there's not been 32,000 civilians killed in Gaza, because the Gaza or Hamas provides numbers without including any Hamas combatant numbers in it. By every metric, the ratio of combatant to civilians, which again is not something I've seen in any other war, but is still historically low for the context of the war. But I would be very skeptical of believing you could have a daily running count to the single digit in any war, let alone in an urban war.
Now, how does the IDF's performance in terms of casualties compare to other modern urban warfare conflicts, you know, whether it be Ukraine or you know, the United States in the most recent wars in Iraq and Afghanistan?
Yeah, Emily, there's three things: lies, damn lies, and statistics. It's really hard to do comparison because no military has faced what the IDF have faced. They haven't faced a combatant of 30,000 embedded in tunnels, over 400 miles of tunnels, 15 to 200 feet underground, that use their civilians as human shields and human sacrifice, because they say they want as many to be killed. But if you were to take like battles of Mosul, Raqqa, Aleppo, other historical urban battles, you know, one, I just never seen anybody do that. Well, what is your combatant to civilian ratio? But even if you did, for some reason, I don't know why you would do that. Is the IDF being legal? Is it following the laws of war, the legal obligation, and taking everything humanly possible to reduce the civilian casualty? That's an absolute yes, they are. And they've done more than any other military in the history of warfare. But even if you took the numbers that Hamas gives and you take the one that Israel's give, because I believe, you know, Israel, a moral democratic government and a military over a terrorist organization. But even if you took all the numbers, the 1 to 2 or whatever the number is historically low compared to those other battles where you have an enemy embedded in urban terrain who says, I'm not leaving. You have to come get me.
Now, one of the accusations which you alluded to has been that Israel is committing a genocide, or that the IDF's actions and the measure taken or not taken to prevent civilian casualties is simply not enough. What kinds of things have you seen the IDF doing in terms of protecting civilians, of avoiding civilian casualties?
Yeah, it's a long list, actually, but since from October 8th on, one of the biggest things that's ever been done in urban warfare is to get civilians out of harm's way, do evacuations. And the IDF did that. They waited 3 weeks and evacuated 85% to 90% of northern Gaza before even beginning the ground assault. And there's techniques that you used in order to do evacuations, like dropping flyers, sending text messages, making phone calls, sending drones with speakers in, dropping speakers from parachutes. But they've been effective in evacuating urban areas before the start of combat operations. But since the world said that wasn't good enough, they developed other mechanisms. They started giving out their maps, like the maps that I teach people on how to do urban warfare. The IDF gave their maps to the civilians and Hamas and said, okay, in these areas, I will be operating in this area. Please evacuate that and stay out of this area. And basically telegraphing every move that they're making and not taking action, even where it would be legal, whether that's on a building or in an area, until they have high confidence that there are civilians out of those areas. So by every measure, that they've done everything you could physically do other than not do the operation. Because really, that's the alternative that the world looks for. like, well, you just should not, you should leave the hostages in captivity. You should not do the operation. You should allow the rockets to continue to be targeting Israel's citizens. It's really interesting on what they think the alternative could be.
Well, we are out of time, but I want to thank you for your insight on this this important issue 6 months on. Thanks for joining us today, Major John Spencer.
Experience the power of truth with ILTV News. If you're looking for quality content and captivating visuals, join our news community and become an integral part of our team as we embark on a mission to unveil the real Israel, dismantling the web of lies and misinformation that surround reporting on Israel. By subscribing to ILTV News, you will not only have access to the latest updates, but you will also amplify our message, creating a ripple effect that carries the truth far and wide. Subscribe today and help reshape the narrative, available on the web, Android, and Apple.
For the first time, an IDF ship mounted with Iron Dome missiles shot down an enemy target. The ship's mounted version of the Iron Dome missile defense system intercepted an apparent drone that entered Israeli airspace near Eilat shortly before midnight. The suspected drone was taken out by Sea Dome, deployed on the Navy's advanced SAR-6C class corvettes. The target had flown in from the eastern direction, from where Iranian-backed militias have fired at Israel repeatedly since the start of the war in Gaza. It was declared operational in November 2022. Drone infiltration sirens sounded in Eilat. The IDF said that the Navy tracked the target before successfully shooting it down, with the Sea Dome system marking its first operational use. There were no reports of damages or injuries in the incident. Eilat residents filmed the moment of the interception over the southern city. Clips posted to social media showed two interceptor missiles being launched from the sea. Iran-backed groups, including Yemen's Houthis, the Islamic Resistance of Iraq, and a group in Syria linked to Lebanon's Hezbollah, have targeted Eilat numerous times since October 7th. The Sea Dome, much like the ground version of the Iron Dome, is capable of downing rockets, cruise missiles, and drones. The Navy's SAR-6 class corvettes are normally tasked with guarding the natural gas platforms off Israel's coast, as well as shipping lanes.
Intense cross-border exchanges are ongoing along the Lebanese border with Hezbollah, mainly on the receiving side. This as the IDF completed a stage of preparations in case the conflict expands into full-blown war. More from ILTV's Steve Leibowitz.
IDF fighter jets carried out strikes on a military compound belonging to Hezbollah's elite Radwan force in Chaim in southern Lebanon. The compound includes 7 buildings used by the terror group. The IDF also struck a Hezbollah command center in Tura. Elsewhere, an elite Hezbollah commander was killed along with 2 others in an Israeli strike on the village of Al-Sultaniya in southern Lebanon. Earlier, a barrage of rockets was fired from Lebanon at the Golan Heights and Manara area. The potential for hostilities to escalate into war continues. Another phase of the IDF Northern Command's readiness for war was completed, centering on operational emergency storages for a broad mobilization of reservists and regular troops, if and when required. This will enable the forces to arrive at the front line in a short period of time for defensive and offensive missions. Meanwhile, the frustration of northern residents out of home for 6 months continues. Tens of thousands of northerners remain evacuated, sitting by helplessly as their communities sustain damages from Hezbollah rocket and mortar fire. This man from Shlomi summed up the feelings of many.
שאנחנו מאוד אוהבים להיות בו ולהריח בו. ובמצב הקיים עכשיו, זה התחיל מאיזשהו מסע של ציפייה, של טוב, אוקיי, ייקח שבוע, שבועיים, שלושה, הסתיים, בינתיים זה מתגלגל ומתגלגל. לא רואים את הסוף. לא ברור גם מה הסוף.
And freed hostage Nili Margalit revealed in an interview with French publication Le Point the harrowing details of October 7th, as she shared horrific details regarding the nature of her kidnapping. According to Margalit, she was kidnapped by Gazan civilians and then trafficked to Hamas. All of the details in the following report.
As part of a larger European tour to raise awareness of the Israelis remaining in captivity, Margalit opened up about her experience being trafficked to Hamas after her capture. The former hostage recounted how she was woken up on October 7th to multiple messages that terrorists had infiltrated her kibbutz. Shortly after, Gazan civilians carrying Kalashnikov rifles that had entered the kibbutz set fire to Margalit's home and dragged her from her safe room. Margalit was then driven in a car to Khan Yunis, where her captors met with Hamas terrorists. She recounted how massive crowds of civilians cheered and her kidnappers were ecstatic. After arriving in Khan Yunis, negotiations with Hamas terrorists began for her price. After the payment was made, Hamas brutally took hold of Margalit and was immediately transferred to a tunnel with 10 other hostages. Many male hostages were heavily wounded after being dragged on motorcycle back, and using her medical experience, Margalit described how she tried helping the other hostages, some of which were also taken from Niroz. Margalit said that they had leaned on each other psychologically, describing the mental games that the Hamas captors would use. Nili Margalit, 41 years old from Niroz, is just one of the voices speaking up about her experience in Hamas captivity, further stressing the urgent need to free the remaining hostages as soon as possible.
Pope Francis has called Hamas evil and bad guys. The comments emerge from a meeting in the Vatican between Francis and family members of hostages taken during the October 7th attack. The Pope vowed to continue working to bring the hostages home. More from ILTV's William Sharon.
The one-hour meeting of the delegation of hostage families with Pope Francis was held to mark 6 months since the Hamas massacre and the assault on Israeli communities around Gaza, in which more than 250 people were abducted as hostages.
Generally, for the most part, we all came out of the meeting with the Pope very emotional. It was a very powerful meeting for us. He was very clear about his solidarity for the release of the hostages. He also told us that he is in contact, obviously, with the Catholic Church in Gaza and how they have told him and shared with him about the hostages and about the terror tunnels and about the theft of humanitarian aid in Gaza, and that he is working in his own channels to help with releasing the hostages, and that he is committed to it.
Those attending the meeting said that the pontiff had very harsh words for Hamas.
And he called Hamas evil, which they are.
He called Hamas even.
Evil. He called them bad guys and evil. And he was very clear that the hostages need to come home. I think, you know, we can all agree. He was very, very warm. And for the most part, we couldn't believe how much time he gave to us and how warm and welcoming he was.
Israelis in southern Israel were hit hardest by the events of October 7th, and in the heart of the south is the Ben-Gurion University. Now, several months after the attacks, they're creating an online event to repair the south and show true Israeli spirit. Remarkable resilience leading the way forward. You can sign up for the event at the QR code on the screen right now or click on the link. But let's take a closer look at this event.
On October 7th, the world shook. We witnessed the most extreme attack on the Jewish people since the Holocaust, as sleeping children were murdered in their beds, families were burned alive in their homes, young adults were shot while at a party celebrating life and peace, and hundreds more taken into Gaza as hostages. The whole country, along with Jews across the world, have been grieving since that Black Saturday, and this is no different for Ben-Gurion University. October 7th directly and disproportionately impacted the BGU community. The university saw its students, faculty, and staff killed, wounded, or taken hostage by Hamas. In the aftermath, many were called up to reserve duty in the Israel Defense Forces. But in the wake of this tragedy, the BGU community regrouped and rallied to help by leading critical and life-saving initiatives, showcasing real Israeli resilience.
הגדנו קבוצה בוואטסאפ שהצטרפו אליה כל דקה, משהו כמו ביום שבת,
משהו כמו 20-30 עובדות סוציאליות, באיזשהו שלב בוואטסאפ שלי פשוט נסגר. וביום ראשון כבר ראינו יותר מ-500 עובדות סוציאליות, ובאמצע השבוע הראשון של המלחמה כבר ראינו יותר מ-700 עובדות סוציאליות, היום אנחנו יותר מ-1,300 עובדות סוציאליות.
Today, the university stands as an anchor institution in southern Israel. As the largest employer in the Negev region, it is not only engaged in education and cutting-edge research, but is also ensuring the economic future and vitality of the South. Americans for Ben Gurion University has announced a global virtual event, Remarkable Resilience, Leading the Way Forward, that will showcase how Ben Gurion University of the Negev is playing a vital role in the recovery and rebuilding efforts in the aftermath of October 7th.
We're going to tell the story of what happened to BGU on October 7th, but importantly, how the university community has really showed its resilience and is really paving the path for the way forward, both for the university, but importantly for the Negev and for Israel.
The Remarkable Resilience Leading the Way Forward event reflects this spirit and the university's understanding that it stands at the forefront of rebuilding the Negev and propelling it forward.
We help support the achievement of David Ben-Gurion's ideas that the future of Israel would emerge from the Negev. And this new campaign we're working on, Way Forward, is in a way a triple entendre. It's the way forward for the university, it's the way forward for the Negev, and in so doing, the way forward for Israel. We're just proud at Americans for Ben-Gurion University to playing this vital role to sustain Ben-Gurion's dream for the Negev, to make it bloom, make it thrive, to be a part of the future of Israel.
Attendees of the webinar will gain insights into how BGU continues to lead the way forward, even in the face of adversity.
For more of the latest updates from Israel, make sure to subscribe to our newsletter at iltv.tv or download the ILTV Plus app. That's it for ILTV's weekly review. Stay safe and see you next week.